Good morning, friends. Welcome for the second day national seminar on Ambedkar and Indian Constitution. I welcome you all. Yesterday we had a very excellent keynote address and then very live debate on various issues. Today we have two sessions before lunch. The first one, Ambedkar and Political Foundations of Democracy. The chair, Professor Sudhakar Rao sir, Department of Anthropology. We have two papers. The first one, Professor Arun Patnaik, Department of Political Science, is going to speak on Ambedkar and Democracy's Nuances. The second one, Professor Keshav Kumar, Delhi University, Ambedkar's Conception of Democracy, a Philosophical Note. So with this, I once again welcome you all. I hand over to Professor Sudhakar sir.
Let me first of all thank Dr. Ratnam for inviting me to chair this session. I know I'm not the right person, but still, he put me at the job. Anyway, I joined Dr. Ratnam that yesterday we had an excellent presentation, keynote address, and followed by very interesting papers. Today, in the morning session, we have two papers which have already been announced. I invite Professor Arun Patnaik to kindly speak on Ambedkar and Democracy's Nuances. I think we can allot 30 minutes to each of these two speakers, followed by a discussion for 15 minutes. I think it should be in order. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sudhakar Rao. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. K. Ratnam for inviting me to share some ideas on Ambedkar's theory of democracy. To begin with, I would like to state a way of understanding Ambedkar's theories. There is a Western philosopher called Hannah Arendt. Students, colleagues will be knowing her. She is a Republican thinker. And Hannah Arendt says that if you look at the history of Western intellectual traditions, there are two kinds of intellectuals. One group, they are large in number. They basically believe in offering a contemplative reasoning. They basically contemplate and offer a reasoning through deeper analysis. That is called philosophers who believe in what Hannah Arendt calls contemplativa activa, or vita contemplativa. And then there is another group of intellectuals who don't believe in mere contemplation. They believe in action. They believe in transformation of society. And they believe in reshaping people's minds through education, what Ambedkar called education, meditation, and organized. So that's called program of action. So that group of intellectuals are called by her intellectuals who believe in vita activa. They just don't contemplate. They believe in action to reshape the world around them and themselves as well. I am slightly discomfortable with Hannah Arendt's binary classification, but I will not argue with her. I take her distinction as useful one to say that Ambedkar belongs to the second stream of intellectual heritage. Now, how do we understand intellectuals who belong to the second stream, that those who believe in vita activa? How do we understand? There is a very complex theoretical problem there. Most of the intellectuals who have commented on Ambedkar are such intellectuals. Don't exceed beyond what they see in the text and speeches. But though I agree that text and speeches are important sources of knowledge for both the groups of intellectuals. We are both the groups of intellectuals engaged in text and speeches. Those who are doing contemplation, they also write, they also speak. Therefore, their ideas are codified in text and the written text as well as speeches, the oral text. But then what is so distinct about those intellectuals who are engaged in action, not just contemplation? I submit that there is another gray area which is relevant for us to understand for those intellectuals who are engaged in practice, not just contemplation, and not just writing texts or advising kings, rulers. They are also engaged in mobilizing people. They are engaged in mass mobilization programs to transform society where they live. Now, how do you understand them? I think there is, I would call a theoretical surplus, which is to say that there is, they say things in excess, which is not seen to us if you read simply their texts and their speeches. You must go beyond what they write and what they speak. You must look at their practice. You must, there are certain ideas which are inherent in their practices. They are not written about it. They are not spoken about it. That is unspoken, unwritten ideas, what Aristotle called practical thoughts. This is true for people like Lenin, Ambedkar, even Gandhi. Those who are engaged in this action programs, those who are engaged in mobilizing masses. There are varieties of practical thoughts in all these which we must pay attention to make sense of a holistic understanding of their theory. So most of the time the theories, left-wing theories, to my surprise, they follow this bit of contemplative mode rather than bit of active mode. Left-wing intellectuals should be involved in bit of active rather than bit of contemplative. But they follow this mode, they forget that they adopt similar methods for people like Lenin, Ambedkar, Gandhi, and so on and so forth. This is a very bad Western habit, and some of the Indian intellectuals also adopted this method, and result of this, there is a theoretical surplus in Ambedkar, which is left out by their theorists. The theoretical surplus arises, as I said, in excess of what is written or what is spoken by Dr. Ambedkar. Now there are large number of ideas, I will tell you how some of them, but there could be many more which are left out. We should discuss, debate this point. I call this theoretical surplus. There is a potential surplus, this theoretical surplus is available to us if you look at Ambedkar's practices. And those practices speak volumes, their imagination, their thoughts of the great leader, which are inherent in his practices. I will reflect on that as I go on. Now, 6 years back I asked Ratnam, I keep asking this question to Ratnam. As Ambedkar, I have a notion of Dalit common sense. This question which has been bothering me for quite some time. If you read his work on annihilation of caste, he assumed that Dalits are superstitious, they are less enlightened, and they are therefore his role is the role of intellectuals to educate superstitious Dalits. They believe in imperial complex, therefore Dalits must transform themselves through a program of education. And that stick is quite seen in his Roman educate, and organize. This is again typical, you know, Rangarist, left-wing Rangarist notion of education program, where the education program is designed by the intellect and professional group of intellectuals like the Communist Party. So Ambedkar represents, you know, typical Communist Party mentality. For a long time I used to think this, I asked Ratnam one day, do you think he has a notion of Dalit common sense? That common sense which is contradictory, which is full of ambivalences, which is Brahminical as well as anti-Brahminical, which is reactionary as well as progressive and democratic, which is non-conformist as well as the non-conformist. Now this ambivalence in Dalit consciousness, Dalit common sense, I use the term from Antonio Gramsci, is it there in Ambedkar? I don't find that in his book. That Gramsci himself, one important clue for me. Gramsci argued that Lenin's, Rupert Lenin's theory, you don't find the entire theoretical corpus available to us in his writings. Some of the theoretical elements are inherent in his practice. That gave me a clue that, this idea could be equally applied to Ambedkar. I feel, though Ambedkar has not explicitly developed a theory of common sense, I suggest that theory is available to us in his practice rather than in his writings, both speeches and texts. This is exactly what I am suggesting. This is the beginning of a democratic thinking, because in my view, an intellectual who is trying to educate public should also be prepared to learn from them. The relationship between intellectual and public should be a dialectical process, where you give something and take something from public. For Ambedkar, duality was very interesting for me. When I checked his practices, I found the very interesting things. This, in my view, is the foundation of a democratic theory. These are the final points of democratic thinking, which I could discern in Ambedkar's practice rather than in his texts and speeches. What is it? Take, for example, his role as a legislator in Bombay Assembly. What was that? I'm talking about 1926-1928. During that period, Ambedkar thought that we must abolish this Inam Dai, Mahavatan. Mahavatan is actually Inam. So, the Mahar community used to do this Vatan, Inam. Inam is a kind of a gift of the government in rendering services. Now, Mahars used to render all kinds of services for the small gifts which were sent to them by different governments. And this Inam Dai rights were hereditary rights. Now, as a result of this, the entire Mahar community was dropped in Inam Dai. Ambedkar argued that this must be abolished. But to place this argument, what he did is very interesting. He had a series of dialogue with different varieties of Mahar Inams, with different varieties of Mahar Vatans, practicing various districts of Maharashtra. This dialogue with the public, that whose cause you represent, is a very important intellectual input. The public is also capable of teaching you lessons, capable of teaching you what you wish to learn from them. This is very important. Ambedkar didn't impose his will to abolish Mahar Vatan. He drafted a bill and he consulted the Mahar community in various districts of Maharashtra, especially southern districts, and he spent a lot of proactive dialogic situations with all those Vatandas or Inamdas among the Mahar communities, and redesigned the bill. He prepared draft a bill, but redesigned the bill after consultation with them, after noticing various practices, after he allowed reasons why it should be abolished. Therefore, this is an important streak in Ambedkar's thinking, which is not there in his writing and speech. But even Dalits are capable of teaching you, Mr. Ambedkar. This is a very important lesson. This is an important lesson that Ambedkar learned from his early days of engagement with the Dalit movement in Maharashtra. He was trying to craft the Dalit movement, he participated, he never assumed that he knows everything. And he represents Dalit interests as such. He never assumed that. This is a very important step. And this is an important lesson for me, because I find that argument is very close to Gramsci's position of common sense. The Communist Party must learn from people. So as the tries to educate people, must be willing to learn from them. Only when this dialectic between party and masses operates, intellectual and masses operate, intellectual could gain hegemony. without this, the intellectual trying to build a counter hegemony will end in a, will raise hopes, will generate a movement, but it won't sustain beyond a point. Therefore, a sustainable counter hegemony program carried out by intellectual must be educative, but at the same time, intellectual must be prepared to learn from people. This is an important lesson I'd like to learn while preparing the draft bill on evolution of this war. But that, don't you work it out? Around 50s, got evolution, but that's an important thing. Similar position he adopted while drafting this Hindu core bill. A series of consultations with what the neoliberals would call stakeholders, direct stakeholders, women, there are several groups of people. He had a series of meetings, he had several dialogue with them. It is through this dialogue he designed that draft bill, Hindu core bill. This is an important moment of practice for me. Mm-hmm. This is one important democratic current in intellectual project. And today, we need this resource very badly because in the left, we tend to assume that we know everything and public is police, less enlightened, less educated, therefore they should learn from us. This, this is a very elitist project, and I have extensively on this elsewhere, and Ambedkar gives us important clue to break free from this elitism. In radicalism, I am talking of elitism in radicalism. Radicalism of paradoxically there is not a elitism and is not free from elitism as well. Therefore, this is enlightened radicalism. Enlightenment basically means, radicalism basically means you must educate the public, public must be enlightened in struggle and to agitate, organize. So therefore, I find the answer to my question I asked Vatram, is there in Dalit common sense? I think there is. In Ambedkar's project. Otherwise, why he should learn from various Inamdar practices in Maharashtra? Why he should learn from the direct stakeholders while drafting the humans, the Hindu code bill in 50s? This is important. If you look at his practice, you will find these reflexes. This is very important for us to recover these practical thoughts about which Ambedkar has not written about, or spoken about. Therefore, you don't find direct, immediate textual evidence. This reason why these thoughts are also neglected by commentators in Ambedkar, and they have not paid sufficient attention to practical thoughts, or what I call theoretical surplus, which is available to us in Ambedkar's practices. This is the first moment of democratic nuance, understanding of democracy. Let me reflect on three more times. Just give me 5 minutes before. I have just 5 minutes before. I make two quick comments, but I would like to I think that Ambedkar's theory of democracy, which is usually seen as an attempt to make a distinction between political democracy and social democracy. Most of his scholars working on Ambedkar's theory of democracy try to argue that Ambedkar distinguishes political democracy from social democracy. That's not the whole picture. Ambedkar offers a very nuanced understanding of democracy. Apart from what I told you just now, there are many more interesting points which must be studied with more carefully. Two tests, Gandhi, Congress, in book on Pakistan. In both texts, Ambedkar offers two interesting ideas of democracy. Well, by Congress represents a democratic current in the anti-colonial struggle. But then what kind of democracy is that? That's a very important story. He never, you know, critical of Congress, and sometimes very vitriolic about that. But nevertheless, moderated, qualified is, he never called Congress undoubtedly, though he was called by congressman, a progressist. He never said Gandhi is progressist. He never said Gandhi, Nehru is progressist. So they are fighting, struggling one way, but they privilege political democracy and missed out the fabric of social democracy. And social democracy is foundation for political democracy. On this, you know, many people have written about it. I will not speak on that. But I'd like to make two more important points, two more important distinctions Ambedkar offers. One is the distinction between democracy as an appeasement policy, and democracy as a settlement policy. This is an important distinction Ambedkar offers in his book on Pakistan. Whereas Congress, for him, a democratic current. So whatever Congress was doing could be read as a democratic focus, democratic thinking. And what kind of democracy Congress was following? Ambedkar said that on the question of minorities, Congress is following policy of appeasement. The policy of appeasement from the 1920s onwards, Muslim separate electorate for Muslim, no separate electorate for Dalits. It's a very interesting dialogue. From 1920 onwards, Congress is following this dual sense, appeasement of minorities. As a result of this, Ambedkar argues that though it is a democratic policy where you keep a community happy through a policy of appeasement, you keep a community happy, therefore you keep a different community happy, therefore the cultural differences are recognized by a program of action. Therefore, that program of action is seemingly democratic, but there is a danger there. What is the danger? It has capability to produce Hitlers. Ambedkar argues that if Hitlers are produced in Muslim community today by reflux impulse, he uses the expression reflux impulse in another context, I use that in this context. By reflux impulse, Hitlers will also come out from majority community. If Hitlers are produced in minority community, Hitlers will also emerge from a majority community. As a result of this, you will find Hitlers across communities, and once Hitlers grow up across communities, the fabric of democracy will become weak. This is a very important lesson for Ambedkar. This important lesson he draws from his analysis of Congress role from 1920 onwards till the birth of Pakistan. And therefore, Ambedkar argues that democracy can't be simply seen as a policy of appeasement. After all, appeasement is what? You are essentially appeasing elites. You are keeping elites of minority communities happy today. But tomorrow, elites will emerge from Hindus and they will demand things. You will also try to keep them happy. As a result, the whole elites from minority community and majority community will produce Hitlers from among them. As a result, the subaltern interest will be undervalued by a democratic project. Democracy, therefore, is a policy of settlement of people's grievances. The grievances of subaltern communities must be addressed by a democratic program. Democracy is not simply a policy of appeasement of majority or minority. If a policy of appeasement of majority or minority, you look at the way their dispute was settled. The majority was minority community was appeased, Sahavanuk got it, and subsequently the block was dismantled by the government. Same government doing appeasement of minority community on one end, followed by appeasement of majority community on the other end. This is what exactly Ambedkar wants, that Indian democracy must be cautious. Indian democracy must slip into a policy of appeasement. It must follow a policy of settlement of people's grievances. Now look at the policy of appeasement, where it has led Dalit Muslims and Dalit Christians today. They feel alienated from the Indian constitution. Because they demand for a long time to recognize that they are Dalits in Muslims, Dalits in Christians, and they must get statutory benefits on par with Dalits among Indian religious communities has not been recognized as yet by the Indian constitution. Therefore, the result of appeasement is a disastrous for Dalit Muslims. And Dalit Christian, now whose interests are appeasing? And in the name of secularism, you are only appeasing the interests of elites, whatever elites, just among Islams and Muslims. They are projecting them as egalitarian religions, whereas they are deeply caste ridden communities as well. And therefore, Dalit communities suffer across these religious communities. They may be non-Indic, their religion doesn't endorse caste pact, religious practices endorse. Therefore, you are not trying to understand, are you trying to understand religion discursively or through practice? In Vidya mode, you must look at practice, not contemplation, not the religious postulate. This is important lesson one learns. Second point which has been missed out by most commentators working on Ambedkar theology. Ambedkar, that there is also another element, another way of distinction in democracy. Democracy as a mechanism and democracy as a value system. As a mechanism, it may believe in retention of power, it may believe in competitive party system, it may believe in periodic elections, so on so forth. It may believe in government opposition, constitutional morality, so on so forth. But that's not enough. If democracy is reduced to mere mechanism, they just conduct periodic elections and let groups participate in political parties, let groups form political parties, let different groups form for different political parties at different periods of time. Democracy is simply reduced to holding periodic elections. Then democratic values will be degraded. Look at today, a large number of intellectuals who celebrate successful democracy in India. From 1990 onwards till now, we find large number of it, from Atul Kohli to Yogendra Jadhav. Several others have been celebrating the successful democracy of India. Democracy has deepened. Jayas and Mandi, Jayas and Andrew, same thing. Now, this is a trap. If democracy has deepened, I would like to know from these intellectuals why same intellectuals are deeply worried about secularism. Democracy is deepened. There is no cause of worry for democracy. If it is dependent, there is no cause of worry for democracy. But then why same intellectuals are deeply worried about the future of secularism under the same fabric of democracy? Is it not a question to ask? This is why Ambedkar argued that this is a trap. If you simply equate a democratic success to success of mechanisms, it is a trap. You must uphold democratic values, values of political, I am not talking about social democracy, I am talking about values of political democracy. Secularism is a value of political democracy, it is not a value of social democracy. Social democracy is not a socialism. Political democracy talks about secularism. Human rights, the bare minimum of human rights, is actually a value system of political democracy. If those values are degraded, democracy cannot be considered as deepened. Democracy as a mechanism has deepened in India in comparison with the systems existing in our neighborhood, yet democracy as a value system is deeply worrisome. Otherwise, several intellectuals are deeply worried about the crisis of secularism and its impact on democracy. And this is where Ambedkar's warning is a valuable lesson for us. This is again an insight which is under theorized, not left out by the existing literature. Therefore, this is the important thing which must be brought into dialogue and discussion. I would like to end my presentation with this. We'll discuss later. Thank you.
So thank you very much. I really wanted you to speak more, and we'd like to know more about these very interesting issues that you have raised, but the time constraint doesn't permit us to go further. Sir, thank you very much. Now I request Professor Keshav Kumar to kindly present his paper. This paper is on Ambedkar's conception of democracy, a philosophical note.